Hello everyone and welcome back to Easy Dentistry, a channel that makes dental education incredibly easy and interesting. We have started uploading lecture on oral pathology series. We have uploaded almost all topics on bacterial infections of the oral cavity. So in this chapter, we are uploading today a very, very important topic, that is syphilis. Many questions are asked in your exams, your UG exams as well as PG entrance exams from syphilis. So watch this lecture carefully. The other name for syphilis is Lewis. So remember this, the alternative name for syphilis. And before proceeding with today's lecture, please subscribe to our channel right now and also share these lectures with all your friends and share knowledge. So in this lecture on syphilis or Lewis, we will be studying the introduction, etiology, acquired syphilis in detail, congenital syphilis, and finally the diagnosis and treatment of syphilis. So starting with the introduction, syphilis is a centuries-old infection which has very characteristic or the protean features. The name syphilis is derived from a handsome and wealthy shepherd who was affected by the disease. So the syphilis comes from the name of that shepherd. The infection was carried to Asia by the Portuguese sailors led by Vasco da Gama. Recently, with extreme use of antibiotics, the spread of syphilis has been controlled a lot. But nowadays, with emerging HIV pandemic, syphilis has returned. So the causative organism, syphilis is caused by Treponema pallidum, which is a spirochete, and it is characterized by episodes of active disease, which is interrupted by periods of latency. So there are active phases as well as latent phases in syphilis. So Treponema pallidum is a gram-positive motile microaerophilic organism, and it can be visualized by dark ground microscopy and by silver impregnation or silver staining. So here you can see the dark ground microscopy. Here you can see the Treponema. These spiral or delicate organisms are Treponema, which can be seen in dark ground microscopy. Also here you can see by silver impregnation method, you can see this Treponema pallidum clearly. Now, the routes of transmission of syphilis is mainly by sexual contact, or it can be spread from mother to child in the form of congenital syphilis. Let us study acquired syphilis in detail. The acquired syphilis is a venereal disease and it is caused by sexual contact with the infected person. But the dentist may acquire it innocently, and the lesions are mainly seen on the fingers of the dentist. While working in the patient's mouth suffering from syphilis, the dentist may acquire the infection. There are three stages of acquired syphilis: the primary stage, the secondary stage, and the tertiary stage. The primary stage, the lesion of the primary stage syphilis is called as chancre, and this chancre, it occurs at the site of inoculation within 3 to 90 days of infection. The lesion may be solitary or multiple. In male, it is mostly seen on the penis, while in the female, it may be seen in the vulva or the cervix. 95% of this chancre occurs in the genitalia, while due to altered mode of sexual contact, the extragenitals may also be affected, such as the lips, tongue, palate, and tonsils. Now, chancre has also been found on the fresh extraction wound in the patient. This chancre is an elevated ulcerated nodule with local induration and associated with regional lymphadenopathy. So here you can see the chancre present at the site of inoculation. This is the chancre. On the lips, the chancre appears as the brownish encrusted lesion, which is vascular. So this is the lip lesion, or the chancre present on the lips. The intraoral chancre is an ulcerated lesion which is covered with grayish white membrane. It is painful and it occurs, and a secondary infection may occur in this intraoral chancre. So here you can see intraoral chancre present on the tongue, the buccal mucosa. Now, the smears from this chancre, if viewed under dark ground microscopy, you may also see Tryponema microdentium, mainly in which is a organism present in the non-syphilitic patient, and enlarged lymphadenopathy is most commonly associated with the chancre. Microscopically, chancre may show intense inflammatory cells with increase in the number of plasma cells. Diagnosis of syphilis from this chancre can be done by taking the smears and staining it with silver stain or by serological tests. Now this chancre, it heals within 3 weeks to 2 months. And then comes the secondary stage of syphilis, which is also called as the metastatic stage. This secondary stage, it starts 6 weeks after the healing of primary lesion. Diffuse eruptions appear on the skin and mucous membrane. So here you can see diffuse eruptions present on the skin. These lesions are multiple macules and papules and are painless. The oral lesions of secondary syphilis are called as the mucus patch. So another important MCQ question, the secondary syphilis oral lesion is called as the mucus patch. These mucus patches are multiple, painless, grayish white plaque over an ulcerated surface. The mucus patch may occur on the tongue, gingiva and the buccal mucosa. So here you can see the mucus patch present on the tongue. Now, these mucus patches are also called as the snail track ulcers because there are multiple ulcers present in a row or along a track. So, it is called as the snail track ulcers. These are ovoid irregular with erythematous zone. Now, here note that mucus patches are highly infective because they have high load of organisms in them. In the secondary stage of syphilis, the serologic test is always positive for the patient. So here, another important MCQ question. In the secondary stage, the serologic test is always positive. Now, what is Lewis magna? Another important terminology asked in your MCQs. This Lewis magna is explosive widespread syphilis. And the characteristic feature are fever, headache, muscle pain and necrotic ulceration. Now this Lewis magna kind of syphilis or widespread disease is mostly found in HIV infected patients. So here you can see the lesions of Lewis magna which are so widespread. Then comes the tertiary stage of syphilis which is also called as the latent or the late syphilis. It occurs several years after the primary infection. It involves the CVS, CNS and certain organs and tissues. It is non-infectious and the characteristic lesion of tertiary syphilis is gamma. Remember, the tertiary syphilis is totally non-infectious. And this gamma is believed to be a hypersensitivity reaction occurring due to host and organism interaction. This gamma may occur on the skin, mucous membrane, liver, testes and bones. This gamma is nothing but a focal granulomatous process with central necrosis. So here you can see the characteristic granulomatous lesion of tertiary syphilis, the gamma. An intraoral gamma may occur on the tongue and palate. The nodular mass may occur which proceeds to form deep painful ulcer. Palatal lesions may cause perforation of the palate by sloughing and formation of necrotic tissue. So here you can see the intraoral gamma, the nodular lesion with ulceration present on the palate. Now, what is Herxheimer reaction or Jarisch-Herxheimer reaction? Another important question. This reaction occurs due to vigorous antibiotic therapy which is given in syphilis. Now, this Jarisch-Herxheimer reaction is a common occurrence in treatment of acquired early syphilis in adults, and it is characterized by chills, fever, generalized malaise, hypotension, tachycardia, tachypnea, attenuation of the cutaneous lesions, leukocytosis, and exceedingly rarely, death may also occur. Another important feature of syphilis is atrophic or interstitial glossitis, which is caused due to end arteritis obliterans or obliteration of the blood vessels. So here you can see the interstitial glossitis seen in the syphilis. And then comes the syphilitic glossitis, which may occur in tongue, and there is fissuring of the tongue, atrophy of the tongue, fibrosis of the tongue musculature, and hyperkeratosis. So this is a picture of syphilitic glossitis. Now here remember, in males, this syphilitic glossitis has 30% chances of undergoing malignant transformation. So another important point to remember here, syphilitic glossitis may undergo malignant transformation and the chances are 30% in males. Now let us study the congenital syphilis, which is a very important short answer question which is asked in your exams. Congenital syphilis is also called as the prenatal syphilis. It is transmitted to the offspring from the infected mother and it is not inherited. It is not inherited. It is transferred from the mother to the offspring. It can be preventable with the use of antibiotics in the fourth month of pregnancy. If antibiotics are used, 95% of the offsprings are free from the disease, but if there is transmission of the infection occurred, 1/3 of the pregnancy will lead to abortion or stillbirth, 1/3 would be normal, and the rest would be suffering from congenital syphilis. Now the clinical features of congenital syphilis, very important to remember, frontal bossing, short maxilla, and high arched palate. So here you can see this baby suffering from frontal bossing or prominence of the frontal part of the skull, and then there is high arched palate and short maxilla. Further features include saddle nose and mulberry molars, Hutchinson's incisor. So here you can see the saddle nose, in which there is a sharp bend in the nose, or a sharp arched nose. Then mulberry molars and Hutchinson's incisors. Mulberry molars are these kind of molars which have numerous cusps. It is like a mulberry leaf. It has many cusps on it. And then the Hutchinson's incisors, these are the characteristic incisors which have if you see these incisors, the incisal edge is notched. Also, the dimension at the cervical area of the tooth is more than than the incisal edge. So the cervical area is broader and the incisal edge is smaller, and also the incisal edge is notched. So these characteristic incisors are called as Hutchinson's incisor. Another name for this Hutchinson's incisor is also called as a screwdriver incisor. So here you can see this tooth is just similar to the tip of a screwdriver. So it is also called as screwdriver incisor. Further features of congenital syphilis includes ragates and sebaceans. Ragates are nothing but perioral or perinasal fissures, and sebaceans is a unique feature found in the tibia of patients suffering from congenital syphilis. This tibia has a sharp bend. So here you can see there is a sharp bowing of the leg. Now, what is Hegominaki's sign? Another important question asked in exam. Hegominaki's sign is seen in patients with syphilis where there is irregular thickening of the sternoclavicular portion of the clavicle. This is also a feature of congenital syphilis. Here, there is irregular thickening of the sternoclavicular portion of the clavicle. This is the Hegominaki's sign. Then the Hutchinson's triad, it is made up of three features: hypoplasia of the incisors and molars, eighth nerve deafness, and interstitial keratitis. So Hutchinson's triad is another important feature seen in congenital syphilis. Now the diagnosis and treatment, mostly done by Wasserman test. Remember these test names, Hinton test. Now, false positive results may also occur if the sampling is not done properly. Exudates from the lesion can be seen under dark ground microscope. Fluorescent treponemal antibody absorption test, treponema pallidum hemagglutination assay are some of the serological tests which are used. The drug of choice is penicillin, then erythromycin and tetracycline can also be used, and surgical correction is one of the method of treatment. So here we complete with the lecture on syphilis. Every point in this lecture is very important. So watch this lecture carefully. The next lecture will be on gonorrhea and granuloma inguinal. That's all for now. Please subscribe to our channel and happy studying.